Welcome to episode 2 of Terrain Rendering. In this video, we're going to study the first out of two algorithms in this series to procedurally generate a terrain. The name of the algorithm is fault formation, and it was previously described in an article by Jason Shankle in the Game Programming Gems. As the name suggests, the algorithm works by creating faults in order to simulate tectonic activity. In practice, we take the grid of quads that our terrain is based on and draw a line between two random points on two different sides. Increasing the height of all the vertices on one side of the line creates our first fault. Depending on the change of height, this may look something like this. Now, I know it looks crappy at the moment, but have no fear, it will improve, I promise. The next step is to simply repeat the process. Another random line, and an increase of the height. As you've probably guessed by now, this is an iterative process, and the more iterations we do, the more interesting and complex the terrain will become. However, since the objective is to mimic a terrain, we're actually going to decrease the change of height in every new iteration. So this is how things look like after 50 iterations, and if you're looking for a Minecraft-style terrain, this might be okay, but for a realistic terrain, we're going to apply an erosion filter to smooth out those rough edges. Yep, something like that. Okay, let's take a look at the software architecture and see where exactly to implement this. The main application creates an instance of base terrain. This class uses array2d to maintain the height map. It also has a triangle list member, which populates the OpenGL buffers with the position of the vertices in the grid. Triangle list takes the height of the vertices from the height map. Base terrain also has a terrain technique member, which manages the shaders and provides access to their uniforms. We're going to create a derived class of base terrain called fault formation terrain. The algorithm will be implemented there and the results will be stored in the height map. This means that we don't need to touch almost anything else in the system. For example, triangle list will continue getting the heights in the same way. There will be a minor addition to the terrain technique, which we will see later. So the fault formation terrain derives from base terrain. It has a function called create fault formation, which takes four parameters. First, we have the terrain size. In the previous tutorial, the height map was loaded from a file, so the size of the terrain was based on the size of the file, but now we are creating the height map from scratch, so we need to specify the size. Next, we have the number of iterations that the algorithm will run. And finally, we have the min and max heights. I would like to be able to control the height range by specifying the minimum and maximum height value across the entire height map. The function createFaultFormation starts by storing the parameters in member attributes and initializing the height map. In the previous tutorial, we provided a height map buffer from the file, but now we are using a different initialization function which just takes the width and depth of the grid and initialization value. The core of the algorithm is implemented in create fault formation internal, and finally, we create the triangle list as usual. The algorithm is pretty simple. We begin by calculating the delta between the expected minimum and maximum height. Next, we loop over the number of iterations. We want to calculate the height by which one side of the random line will be increased, and as I said, we want this value to decrease as we make progress. So we start by dividing the current iteration index by the number of iterations. This provides a fraction between 0 and almost 1. I say almost 1 because the loop uses the less than sign. Next, we multiply this fraction by the delta height and subtract it from the maximum height. So for example, if the height range is 0 to 100 and the number of iterations is 10, we will increment by 100 on the first iteration, 90 on the second, 80 on the third, and so on. As you can see, this will go well over the expected maximum height, but we will normalize it later. Now let's generate the random points. The terrain point is a simple structure with X and Z as members. It also knows how to compare itself to another terrain point. The function genRandomTerrainPoints generates two random points within the range of the terrain size. The creation of the second point is inside the while loop because we don't want to randomize two identical points. In such cases, I like to add a condition to make sure I don't end up in an endless loop because of a bug or something. Notice that the two points are not restricted to the sides of the terrain. What we really need is to calculate the vector between them. And this is what we do here. Dear x is the delta on the x-axis, and dear z is the delta on the z-axis. We now need to loop over all the points in the grid and increment the height of all the points on one side of the random line, while keeping the other side unchanged. How do we know whether some point is on one side or the other? In a 3D coordinate system, the cross product of two vectors provides a vector which is perpendicular to the plane created by the two vectors. We usually use the left or the right hand rule, depending on the handedness of the system, to make the resulting vector point toward the positive half space. In this case, we can calculate a vector between every point in the grid to one of the random points and do a cross product between this vector and the vector that goes between the two points. Since we are in a 2D coordinate system, it means that z is zero. The result of the cross product will be negative on one side of the random line and positive on the other. We don't really care which side we're going to increase, so we will simply choose one of them and stay consistent. The cross product equation in 2D is very simple. We multiply the first element of the first vector by the second element of the second vector and subtract the first element of the second vector multiplied by the second element of the first vector. Hope I said it correctly. So here we have a nested loop over the x and z axes, which traverses all the points in the grid. We calculate the vector from each point to the first random point and the cross product between this vector and the initial random vector. Since we are positive people here, we will increment the points whose cross product is positive. This is very simple with the Array2D class. It has a function which fetches the value of a 2D coordinate. We add the height which was calculated at the beginning of the iteration and set it back into the same cell. And that's pretty much it in terms of the core algorithm, but before we can render it, we need to take care of a couple of things. First of all, we have the problem of heights going outside of the required range. Therefore, once we exit this function, we call normalize on the height map, passing in the minimum and maximum height. Since this operation is very common, I've made it part of the Array2D class. It scans the array and finds the actual minimum and maximum values. Then it maps this range to the required one using a simple equation of a linear mapping. The second thing to take care of is to get rid of the hard-coded 200 which I placed in the vertex shader in the previous tutorial in order to kind of normalize the Y value. We have to make this generic, so I've added a couple of uniforms for the minimum and the maximum height. We calculate the delta between them and then normalize the Y by subtracting the minimum height and dividing by the delta. Now I don't want to use it like that because the lowest parts of the terrain will be too dark, so we map it to 0.2 to 1. The final result is set into all the components of the color. No change is required in the fragment shader. The next step is to update the uniforms on the application side. I've added a couple of corresponding uniform locations to Terrain Technique, as well as a function that provides their values. Now we need to actually call setMinMaxHeight, and we do just that back in the createFaultFormation function. Also, make sure to call glUseProgram before setting the uniforms, and this is what the enable function of the technique class does. Okay, we are now ready to test it for the very first time, so let's go back to the main application code and change base terrain to fault formation terrain. In the initTerrain function, we set a few values for the terrain size, the number of iterations, and the minimum and maximum height. We can now call createFaultFormation, and as expected, the result looks very rough. The solution is to apply an erosion filter to smooth out the height map And the suggestion of the book is to use something which is called finite input response filter, or FIR. Not to be confused with the first-person shooter, which by the way is awesome. We can easily visualize the effect of this filter using a spreadsheet. Let's create a column of random numbers between 0 and 100. Throw this into a chart and it looks similar to our terrain, only in 2D. The FIR filter needs a factor between 0 and 1. 0 will keep the values unchanged, while 1 will make all values equal, so let's set it to a half. We start the filter operation by copying the first value into a new column. The next value is basically a linear interpolation between the next value in the previous column and the previous value in the new column. Let's create a chart from the new column, and it looks pretty much the same, but if we repeat this process, then eventually we can clearly see that we are getting something here. So let's jump to the code and create a function called applyFIRFilter, which takes the factor as a parameter. We will scan the height map along the z-axis and apply the filter on each row separately from left to right. The initial value is set to the first value on the current row. We go over the row from the second value until the end of the row and call FIRFilter single point using the new coordinate, the previous value, and the filter factor. This function returns the new previous value so that the loop can continue correctly. FIRFilter single point does exactly what we saw in the spreadsheet. It fetches the value at the next coordinate and performs linear interpolation between the previous value and the new one. Then the new value is updated in the height map and returned to the color to be used as the previous value in the next iteration. Okay, we need to call applyFIRFilter after the main loop in createFaultFormation internal. We also need to provide a filter along the call chain from the topmost function. The main application code must provide a value for the filter. Let's test it, and it doesn't look like it has changed a lot. So let's add a second sweep. This time we go from right to left. It's the same thing, we just need to start from the last value and reverse the inner loop. And we do get some improvement here. Okay, let's cut to the chase and do a couple more sweeps. First, from bottom to top. So the outer loop is now over the x-axis, and the inner loop goes over the z. Everything else is the same. And finally, from top to bottom. Okay, things are now looking pretty good. We can play with different filters and see that lower factors make the terrain very rugged, and higher factors create nice rolling hills and mountains. Okay, before we wrap up, I'd like to say a big thank you to Daniel Ibarguen, who recently joined the OpenGL Underground. If you too would like to support this channel, you can do that at patreon.com/OGLDEV. Thank you for watching, and I hope to see you in the next episode of Terrain Rendering.